doesn't tonight is the minutes of the previous meeting. The previous meeting was January 19th, 1993. The February meeting was postponed to the weather. Some of the items on the agenda tonight are carryovers from that meeting. Is there any comments, corrections, discussion on the meeting, the minutes of the January 19th?
Minutes of the meeting.
One small correction on page 2. Under In by the Sea, it states that Mr. Parkhurst knows he had dealings with the previous owners. It should mean the present owners.
Any other changes, corrections, questions? Okay, all of us here were present at the time. Do I hear a motion?
I move we accept the minutes as amended.
Second. It's been moved and seconded. Any other discussion? All those in favor of the approving the minutes as amended, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's unanimous. Next order of business is to review the correspondence over the last 2 months. Include Environment and Development January newsletter, a letter from the Conservation Commission from January 21, 1993. Those are the minutes of that meeting. A letter from the Normando Associates in reference to the Inn by the Sea, dealing primarily with water testing. I think it's also part of the Inn by the Sea application. Memorandum from the Public Works Director in reference to the Highlands at Broad Cove. Memorandum from the Code Enforcement Officer in reference to the Highlands. Did I skip one? Inn by the Sea. Also a memorandum from the Code Enforcement Officer in reference to the Highlands. We have an Environment and Development February newsletter, Environment and Development. I think they ought to change the name of their brochure. March newsletter. Cumberland County Housing News, winter edition of 1992. Takings in Maine conference, legal conference. It's part of the packet. I have to get through some of this. From the School of Law, University of Maine. I'll say there's certainly in our correspondence plenty of opportunity for board members to attend different conferences, educational opportunities. If you are interested in any of these, mention it to Maureen. The town in the past has been very good at assisting board members to attend if you see something of interest. A rails and trails workshop, water quality monitoring fair, 1993. I should know what NNECAPA spring workshop. What is that, Maureen? Something to do with planners, I think.
Northern New England chapter of the American Planning Association.
Just seeing if you remembered. Thank you. Oh, she's an officer. Best management practices workshop. A letter from Michael Hill in reference to the Highlands subdivision. A letter from Susan Pierce, who is an abutter, I believe, to the Highlands subdivision. A letter from Richard Sullivan in reference to the Highlands subdivision. And a memo from the code enforcement officer in reference to Beale's ice cream. I got a big pile. Is there any other correspondence from the board members to be submitted? Did I see that? I'm told that there's one here at the podium. When I sat down, I've already lost it. There we go. It's a memo dated this day from Ernest McVeigh to Maureen O'Meara in reference to Conservation Commission dealing with a proposed footbridge, whether it would need engineer's review, and the code enforcement officer deems that he will not require an engineer's review. like to welcome two new associate members. Number one, I should welcome two new full members of the board. Judy Lardner, who's been an associate for some time. As many as, what, 2 years or longer?
Almost
3 years. As an associate member, has been appointed to a full member of the board. Mark Wilcox, who has been with us for how many months as an associate? 3.5 months. Also appointed as a full member. Two new associates have been added to the board. First, Peter Carter, who has some background in town management, I believe in Booth Bay, is that correct? Is now in automobile sales, has been a resident of Cape Elizabeth for 10 years. Bob Marvin, who manages real estate holdings in the Greater Portland area, primarily South Portland. And has lived here in Cape Elizabeth for, what, a year and a half or so, 2 years? Welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
You may have some action tonight as appointed members, but we're missing Tom Emery as a full member. The first order of old business is the Highland Subdivision Amendments, request by Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments. I'm going to back up. You're not ready yet. Thank you. First order of old business, election of planning board officers. First order of business is to take nominations for planning board chair. Do I hear any motions? It's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Are there any other nominations? No other nominations. All those in favor of Steve Etzel as planning board chair for the next year, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Next order of business is to elect a vice chair. Do I hear any nominations?
I'd like to make a motion to nominate Tom Emery as vice chair.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to nominate Tom Emery as vice chair. Any other nominations? No other discussion. All those in favor of Tom Emery as the vice chair for the next year for the Cape Elizabeth Town Planning Board, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. All in both unanimous votes. Now, on to the first order of old business as the new chair.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman. As in the past, I have to step down regarding this particular issue.
In the past, we've had you mention why or give some summary why you felt you have a conflict or bias. I think it is as of record. Unless there's question by other board members, including associates, we'll accept your excusing yourself. Okay. In Steve Parker's absence, I will appoint Peter Carter as a voting member. Before I do that, I'll ask you first if you feel that you've had a chance to review the information and feel like you could participate as a voting member tonight.
Yes, I have reviewed.
Good. Okay. To fill Tom Emery's position, also appoint Bob Marvin as a voting member. Before I do so, I'll ask you if you have had a chance to review the information and feel you feel comfortable in voting on the issue.
I have reviewed the information, but I also have a conflict.
Could you tell, just give us some background to the conflict?
Mr. Frinsko is representing my firm in a current action in South Portland.
Okay. We'll continue with this first article under old business with four planning board members. Now, the second order of old business. The Highland Subdivision Amendments, request by Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the previously approved Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, Channel View Road, Subdivision Ordinance Section 16-2-5. Ask that the applicant or representative of the applicant please come to the podium and give us a brief summary of the request.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I'm Paul Frinsco, here on behalf of Greater Portland Development Group. I'm going to try to be brief this evening. I know you have an agenda that may take some time. The application before you this evening is very, very minor. The plan, which I don't believe the board received a colored rendering, but that's been placed up on a double sheet to show the full length of Jordan Farm Road and the relocation of the road to the north. I'm going to ask Mr. John Swan of Owen Haskell in just a moment to come up and go over with you in detail the actual change. The second change is a relocation of the sanitary waste, or an alternate location of the sanitary waste disposal system on Lot 4. And I believe that you have in your package a copy of the HHE 200 form showing the approval by a licensed soil scientist for the system and confirmation from the code enforcement officer of the system. And then the third change is a relocation, and I think that this particular term on the plan, which says fence on Lot 4, I think that's a misnomer. That really refers to the gates which were originally approved on the original recorded plan, emergency access gates, and that should be gate and not fence. And what the plan shows is the actual location of this gate should be determined by the owner, dependent upon where the owner's driveway is going to be located for Lot 4. And perhaps John Swan could just detail for you the change in the location of the road.
Thank you. As Paul said, my name is John Swan. I'm with Owen Haskell Surveyors in South Portland. What we've shown here tonight is the in yellow was the original design location of the emergency access road as approved by the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. The red labeled proposed relocation is just that. That is the proposed relocation of the emergency access road, and by design it is to generally follow the area which in fact has been cleared to date.
Just so I have it straight, the red is the proposed change, the yellow was
the
approved
relocation. That's correct. The yellow was the original design location that was approved by you prior to this. As Paul mentioned, there are, and it was mentioned in the town planner's memo, there are three gates or fences shown on these plans. There's a gate installed chain and posts at the end of the what I'm going to call the public section of the Jordan Farm Road. That gate is where it was proposed and is intended to stay there. At approximately station 1500, there's location of gate to be determined by property owner. That was the approximate location of the original gate that was proposed. Part of Mr. Kennedy's amended plan is to relocate that gate somewhere in the vicinity of location of fence to be determined by the owner. It's not the intention to have three gates or fences. There's the fence at the westerly end. There's the gate. There's the gate that was originally proposed. which may be relocated if the alternate house site is used on Lot 4.
Is that the reason for the possible change, that there are two possible building locations on Lot 4?
That's correct. The original lot or building envelope was on the easterly side of Lot 4. There is an alternative building site with soil test on the westerly side of Lot 4. So depending on the location of the house would affect the location of the emergency access gate or fence.
You know what I'd like to do, only because it's very hard to see from here, and we usually don't leave the podium. I think it would be okay if the board members would like, if we just take a couple minutes and walk down. Take your maps, if you want to jot notes or take notes. Well, I'd rather not center the discussion down there, only because the microphones are back here. But if we could just walk down and take a look for 2 or 3 minutes at the plan.
Or I can bring it up there, whichever is convenient for you.
I think we'll just walk down there if it's okay.
Basically anywhere in the location of Lot 4.
Thank you for your patience.
Everything for January.
Hopefully the board members have had a chance to take a look at it, and if have questions, I think we need to try to be able to refer to it by road station or like a location. Not opposed to going down and taking another look, but sorry to interrupt you. It's Mr. Swan, is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah, if you wanted to, can you have more to say? I'm sorry.
The only other thing that I wanted to mention to you was for the record, we'll refer to the road by station. Is that?
That's the easiest, I think.
In the area of station 18+0, you'll see that the red or proposed redesign is quite a bit northerly of the yellow original design. The reason for that is that it was always the intent that this emergency access road follow the existing tote road that was out there. And through an error, and I'm not prepared to tell you whether it was a survey error or a design error, but it was an error in any event. The original design was, at least in our opinion, located southerly of where we thought the tote road was. So that's the reason for the larger discrepancy here. Other than that, it's as has been discussed for months.
Just from the murmurings and questions that were done, could you go back over the proposed changes in the gates or what's referred to as fence, what right. is actually being proposed?
Okay. My understanding is that there were two proposed gates as the project was originally designed. One at the end of, again, what I'm going to call the public or paved portion of the Jordan Pond, Jordan Farm Road. The other gate was located and proposed just westerly of the proposed driveway for lot 4 as originally designed. What Mr. Kennedy is now proposing as an alternate site, that there are two building sites on lot 4, if in fact the westerly building site, that site in the area of station 12+0 is used as a house site, then it would necessitate moving the gate down to approximately station 11+25, where we show a proposed fence. There's still intended to be two gates, but the easterly gate location would be dependent upon the house site to be used on lot 4.
Okay. I guess unless Mr. Frinsco has any further comment, we'll move on to board questions.
Question.
Okay. Comments, questions, concerns from the board? Judy?
I have a tremendous list, but I don't know how you want to do this.
Fire away.
If you want to do item by item. First, I'd like to say I'm very disappointed that the board has not seen any plans of that nature, considering I asked for them in December or earlier. It's very difficult to come to a board meeting now and ask us to jump up and look at a plan there that we could have had months ago and studied at our leisure.
You did have them quite some time ago.
We did not have any plan that clearly depicted the changes, and that is clearly what I asked for, Mr.
Frenzel. The chair knows that I did bring the plans to the meeting. Unfortunately, some people were absent.
Okay.
This plan that you have up on the board was made available. I think what Judy is referring to is we haven't had in our own possession as board members a plan that shows, delineated clearly, what was the old approved road.
Let me just remind you the suggestion I made. If the plans are drawn to the same scale, if you take one plan and put it over the other, you can readily
see
the difference.
We don't keep plans. If we all kept plans, we don't come here to study them. We study them in our own house. We don't keep. If I kept plans for the last 4 years, we'd have two or three rooms full. That wasn't what's available to us.
The town has plans. I know that.
Judy, go ahead.
I may be somewhat redundant because I have my notes organized in two different ways. I'll try to go over the order of the memo first, I think. With respect to the emergency access gates, I'll ask Maureen this first. Do we have any sense of DEP approving the relocation of the road or the relocation of the access gates?
I spoke with Linda Coker-Miller, who's been the person reviewing this application. The applicant has submitted a formal request for modification of the DEP order. She, however, has informed me that she will not have an answer available on whether or not the amendments will be approved until probably at least May.
And that will be a formal amendment to the order
right.
that we can receive.
So she hasn't spent a lot of time looking at the plans. She did say, however, that the gate locations would have to be fixed and leave them in flux at some future point would not be acceptable to her. It's possible that once she does a full review of the plans, she won't find any problem with that, but it's been DEP's position from very early on that the position of those gates was very important.
I don't know if she spoke to this or if any other board members have thought about this, but clearly the town wanted this as a through road originally, and I thought would then settle for a gated emergency access and wanted it paved, and then they couldn't have it paved, and that is still in the works too, isn't it, the idea of whether it will be paved or not?
Yeah, and speaking with her, I've mentioned the paving several times, and right now the sense I am getting is a very strong sense that they will not oppose the paving as long as the width of the road remains the same.
And there's
in no case will we be paving a road that's any wider than the area that's supposed to be gravel right now.
Is it your understanding they still wish to see that as an emergency access only that's gated?
Yes. There was discussion about perhaps, because the gates are moving so close together, having one gate instead of two. But then the issue becomes how do people turn around, because there's only a turnaround on the two light side of the road. Mm-hmm. There's no turnaround on the other side.
I guess that's one of my concerns, is we were told that this shouldn't be a through road because of it's a very sensitive natural area, and yet this proposal would, in essence, half the area that's going to be protected. I think it's less than half. So I'm kind of confused why it's being protected, and if it's still a valid reason that it's very sensitive and should be protected, it seems unreasonable to move the access gates. That is my opinion on that. On the road paving, I know Mr. Frinsco raised this at a previous meeting when we weren't allowed to discuss it. I know the history of this project was that it was always the town's intention to have it paved, and it was Mr. Kennedy's intention to pave it. And I remember an earlier, it wasn't a condition of approval, but before the board did approve this, he was required to go through some formal amendment request to get it paved. So I trust that when we hear from the DEP, we will hear from Mr. Kennedy as to whether he will be doing that.
Well, I can answer that question now. The application before you does not include a request to pave the road. From day one, the developer has agreed with the planning board, or has told the planning board that its agreement with the community officials is that the developer will cooperate with the town in the event the town wishes to have the road paved.
Okay, that's something we will have to clarify, I think, before we finally approve this. With respect to the DEP amended order, I certainly, as one board member, favor seeing that finalized before I take a vote on this, but I will certainly cede to the board's desires. On the consent agreement, I know that's been addressed since this memo was written. On the wetlands restoration plan, either Mr. Frinsco or Maureen, is that wetlands restoration plan been submitted to DEP for their approval?
It was part of the package that went to the DEP.
Okay, so
I thought you folks all got a copy of that package. It shows it being copied to the town.
Yes, but I don't know if that's part of the formal application to DEP and you expect to receive approval.
I meant
approval.
That. My files show a copy of the DEP application as going to the planning board.
Perhaps I could clarify this. Mr. Frinsco, when it's copied to the town, there's usually one set of plans that's delivered to me and is filed in my office, but there are not seven sets that are delivered so that the planning board knows whether or not exactly the same thing has been submitted. I can tell you that it was in the package that was submitted to me, but the board wouldn't know about that.
Thank you, Maureen. Let me see now, going back to the beginning. There was a mentioning of new drainage easement proposed on Lot 5. We need to see some language to that effect to be approved by our Corporation Council if we haven't already received that. The engineer's comments need to be addressed, and he had some comments about the erosion control plan. The one I would specifically second is he indicates that where the applicant's consultant is responsible for something, that applicant's consultant should be specified by company name. And I'd like, at some point after other board members have commented, to have a little more explanation of why the landscaping at the entrance is being changed. I think I'd leave it at that.
Can I ask your first question?
Yes.
On the drainage easement?
Mm-hmm.
If you have plan C-103 revised to January 28th,
mm-hmm.
If I can show you directly below the 5 test pits.
I've seen the easement on there.
Yeah, well, that's...
That we haven't, I haven't seen the proposed easement. I haven't, this is a new one, I believe, since we approved all the other formal easement language.
Indeed.
I don't believe you do. I think that noting on a plan an easement is adequate, but it certainly is not difficult to do. Once you record a plan showing an easement on there, the easement is transferred.
For now.
Okay, that's it. Any other questions? Comments? Anything, Mark?
Yes, I have a question regarding the gates. The new access then is definitely going to be from the easterly end of the access road, and the chain and posts shown at the end of the paving on the west end remains in place and chain drawn.
This one over here?
The chain is actually at all the way at the left-hand end of the red stripe. There's a chain and posts, and that remains in place and chain drawn.
Let me just ask the designer.
I'm sorry. What was the question?
The chain and post is at the very left-hand end of the red
right,
stripe.
Right, yes.
That remains chained?
That remains.
Chained at all times? So,
as far as I know, I mean, that's...
So the access is definitely from the east end.
From the east.
And it just depends on which gate location would be chosen by the...
That's correct.
...future owner of Lot 4.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I just have a couple of questions or comments, and I think somebody else had mentioned dealing with the developer's consultant, making sure that consultant is either identified or remain.
Yes, it's Stephen Moore.
Okay, I think that needs to be made specific. By the record, I don't think that it states that it's Stephen Moore anywhere else in the record. The issue, the plan itself, I'm not sure why you left the fence. If you seem to make it quite clear that it's not a fence, that it's either a gate. Number one, you have the issue of movable gates, and I think you've seen that that's not acceptable for at least a few of the members of the board. That they need to be stationary so we know where the gates are going to be. Number two, simply, if it's not a fence, don't call it a fence, call it a gate.
Really an error.
Remove it from the plan as such. I guess only in my own absent amount of time to read through all of the information on the alternate location of the septic system in Lot 4. The reason for that is to gain the second building window. Is that the purpose of that?
The purchaser an alternate site location for a home. Yes, sir.
Okay.
We're in a bit of a dilemma. The current proposed purchaser would like to utilize the other building location. But obviously the current proposed purchaser is not going to close this transaction if he does not have a recorded plan that accurately depicts what he intends to buy. Some other purchaser, Mr. Chairman, quite candidly, may prefer the other location.
Mm.
I understand the concern about fixing the location of the gate. I don't believe that there's any problem.
I think, less of an extreme than being very close together, that the location is not that important. I think the objection is the fact that there's no solid location. It's left at the window.
I understand that.
I think that's the real key issue. Judy, do you have any further questions?
One thing I missed, but the memo suggests that a performance guarantee for the wetlands plantings might be something we would consider, and I certainly would favor that as a board member. I don't know how easily that would be to define, because the wetlands restoration plan talks about putting plantings where necessary, and it's not as straightforward as a landscaping plan where you can count out the number of plants. But perhaps the applicant can put together some sort of proposal that might address that.
A comment or a question I have of the board members. The board has an option to schedule a public hearing in reference to this article. I'll leave it up to the consensus of the board, whether the board feels that there's a need for a public hearing. Just for the new members to this application, Maureen, perhaps if you could you give us maybe a little history on the public hearings and so forth? How many of them might have been?
On this application? This application has been before the board for, I think, since 1987. So a typical major subdivision, which this one is required to have, usually has a public hearing during the preliminary approval. And then another public hearing was held for the final plan approval, which was granted, I believe, in May of 1990 or 1991. So there have been at least two public hearings on this application so far. For a subdivision amendment, the board is not required to hold a public hearing, but does have the option of doing so if they feel that there are substantive changes which the public may want to comment on. Other than a public hearing, the only other opportunity the public has to comment on issues before the board is through correspondence. And the board has received, I believe, four letters from residents requesting that a public hearing be held. But again, it is at the option of the board. It's not a requirement of the ordinance.
Any comments, any consensus on the board, Judy?
I would favor
okay.
A public hearing.
Mark?
I would favor a public hearing also.
Peter?
And so would I.
Okay. I guess it's just been the nature of the Cape Planning Board that we do tend to have lots of public hearings and that we're interested in input. I'm not, just as one board member, I'm not sure that I've been, I think, with this almost since the beginning of this application. The extreme need for one. I was not aware that the four letters requested a public hearing, but I'm sure, Maureen, your memory is much better than mine. If that's so, that the letters actually requested a public hearing, I think it's in the best interest that we do.
Well, I can just inform the board. I have received numerous calls and visits from residents who have some concerns they'd like to raise.
I think it's consensus of the voting members that we have a public hearing. Are there other questions for this evening's discussion? I think it seems clear that we're going to have a public hearing, which means we will be having another meeting. I think what I'd like to make sure that the applicant understands is what issues need to be resolved, what changes, if any, we need to discuss further with them. Mark?
I think one area that could perhaps be the wetlands restoration plan right now seems to be fairly carefully crafted. I would say that review and standards for judging whether or not it's been successful or whether replantings are needed could perhaps be maybe a little bit more specific than just if they need to be done, sort of what constitutes them needing to be redone, because the maintenance and monitoring section is fairly succinct in outlining what would be done should materials need to be replaced or in order to ensure the success of the restoration effort, but maybe perhaps some I don't know if there's any way of really making it quantifiable, but sort of what constitutes the need in that area.
Okay. I see a furrowed brow with question.
I'm trying to think what how dead is dead, or help me out.
I wouldn't say how dead is dead, but if there are 100 plants of grass plugged in and two of them die, I don't think it would be a failure of the wetlands restoration effort.
Oh, I see.
However, if 100 plugs of grass, of a special kind of grass, are put in and all of them die, I think that there would be a real interest and a desire to see the situation rectified.
I would agree.
Yeah.
Some standards for determining compliance.
Some standards or somebody's impartial professional opinion or some such mechanism, perhaps, added to this maintenance and monitoring section of the plan.
Yeah, I just assume that the town engineer and their staff would work along with a consultant to ascertain completeness, but if that could be fleshed out, I'm sure we'd be happy to do it.
Okay. Judy, I guess, Paul, is that... Would that be the best way to proceed to the next meeting? Is it it's clear to you? Are the points of contention? Are the problems with comments that you've heard from the board this evening? Or is it clear to you what the board is looking for?
I've heard the comments with respect to the performance guarantees. We've never had a problem working out that language with the staff. And I don't expect we'd ever have one again. It's clear there's an error on the plan in terms of the designation of a fence where it should be a gate. As to the location of the gate, other than the fact that I think that it should be fixed, I guess the question is, are there any areas that the board finds would be inappropriate to locate one of the two gates? That would be the helpful thing to understand.
I don't think, and maybe the other board members will disagree with me, but I don't think it's necessary our role to tell you where the gates should be. But I understand you're not saying that. But I think something as simple as option A and B,
okay,
mirroring, if this window site is used, this is where the gate will be. If it's this one, then the gate will be here. And we can either say that's reasonable or it's not. Yeah, proceed. Other than saying, well, it's a slide rule and we'll move it somewhere in this lot. I think perhaps if the applicant would be willing to retain the Soil and Water Conservation Service, perhaps to monitor the wetlands alteration plan, that might be a solution. They're familiar with it, and fear a third party to monitor that. Maybe that's the best way to go about it, if there are questions that you have. I want to make sure that it's clear to you when you do return that issues don't continue to pop up, and that we're addressing them and that you're addressing our concerns as well. Judy?
I'd say the biggest stumbling block from my perspective is I can't vote for this until I see some DEP approval for various reasons. I think the other things are more straightforward. The paving, I think, is an issue too. And it's my understanding that the paving would be done by Mr. Kennedy, not in cooperation with the town. And if that's not correct, I would expect Mr. Kennedy and Mr. McGovern to talk about that. So I know when we get to a final point what Mr. Kennedy will propose to do and what Mr. McGovern, speaking for the town, is proposed to accept. This is a town road, irrespective of its unusual configuration. So I will look to hear what he has to say.
Which he?
Mr. McGovern.
Oh, okay.
About what they view about the towns.
Yeah. The application before you does not include a request by the developer to pave the road. The position of the developer remains as it has been since day one in this project. If the town would like to pave it, we will cooperate with you in terms of whatever approvals you need to obtain.
Anything else, Judy?
Probably not that I haven't mentioned.
Okay. Any other board question, comments? If not, do I hear a motion for any action?
I have a question first. If
Certainly.
We were talking about a public hearing, at what point were we talking about a public hearing?
I would assume that if we were to have a public hearing, it would be at the next meeting. I mean, if there's good reason not to have it at the next meeting, certainly let me know. But I think that would be appropriate.
And we had a motion that was proposed for us that said it would be tabled to such and such a meeting if certain items were submitted. If those items are not submitted, does that mean that the public hearing would not be held? Because one of the items was that we have written confirmation from DEP.
I think I'd ask the town planner how that works. If there are requirements of posting public disclosure, public notice of a public hearing, and how we coordinate that with the receipt of certain information. Maureen?
The reason the motion you have before you was drafted the way it is, and it certainly can be revised, is that it was my understanding at the last meeting in December that the board had wanted a certain threshold of information submitted before this application returned to you for review, and that information had not been submitted. I was instructed that I have no authority to withhold any kind of application from the agenda, regardless of whether or not information has been submitted. So I just wanted to put the board on notice that if you felt strongly that you didn't want to see another plan until it was complete, that that has to be in the motion for tabling. It can't just be a motion for tabling, because it will automatically come back at the next meeting. In terms of scheduling a public hearing, if you wanted to make a motion to table something, and require that information be submitted prior to it coming back at the next meeting. The submission deadline for planning board meetings is 18 days in advance of the meeting. So that gives me more than sufficient time to determine whether or not I need to notice for a public hearing.
I think the language in a motion could indicate upon receipt the public hearing be scheduled and notice for the subsequent meeting.
I might favor, as one board member, and that's why I'm hesitant to make the motion, that we go ahead and hold a public hearing. If there are new items that the applicant needs to address, they have time. I'm hesitant to give them a list of things to do and hinge the public hearing to that, and then if they don't get DEP till May or June, they come back and there's something new thrown at them.
Mm-hmm.
So given that, what I would like to propose for the board to consider: be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channel View Road, be tabled to the regular April 1993 Planning Board meeting, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second? It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
I'd like to second the motion.
It's been seconded. Moved and seconded. Is there further discussion?
One comment.
Judy?
I would certainly see a motion at the next board meeting to include a list of items that the applicant would need to provide before we would then take up the item again for discussion.
Are you suggesting that that's a part of the motion?
No, that would be something that the applicant would hear from us next time. Not that I think the items on this proposed motion are not valid.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the inappropriate time to say that. I don't want the public hearing held up because of them.
Okay. Could you, I hate to have you read the whole thing, but could you go back over the motion one more time?
I had said, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channel View Road, be tabled to the regular April 1993 Planning Board meeting, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
I guess I could have just had you read the final clause, but thank you very much. That was the motion and has been seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
If I'm correct, is the regular meeting the third Tuesday, like tonight?
It's April 20th.
20th, thank you.
See you then.
I'm going to leave this for you with that.
Sure.
Okay.
Next order of old business this evening is the Cantel Corporation Public Access Waiver, request by Juan Perez of the Cantel Corporation for a wetlands alteration permit and a public access waiver for a lot located off Silver Drive, U46-9A, wetlands permit, public hearing, section 19-3-9, public access waiver, section 19-4-2B. If the applicant or a representative of the applicant could approach the podium.
The applicant and representative are here.
Welcome. I guess what I'd like to have you do is just a brief update of where we are, and right after that I'll open the public hearing.
Okay, what I'd like to do is just to show you very quickly how the plan has changed since the last time, and we're prepared to answer any questions that you have about the earlier version of the plan. My name is Terry DeWan. I'm a landscape architect in Yarmouth, and I'm here on behalf of Juan Perez of the Cantel Corporation. And we have two items that we'd like to discuss tonight. One is the request for public access waiver, and secondly is the wetlands alteration permit. If you recall, we were here in January before the board, and the board found that our application was complete. We were scheduled to be on the February agenda. It was called due to snow, and we were back again. And we're here to present a number of changes that were made, partially as a result of the information we received at that meeting, partially as a result of additional responses and reviews we've had by various people within the town and reviewers. What I've done is shown you the plan that we presented last time. I also have a site analysis, which we could also discuss if you need. And we have another plan, which you have in your packet, that was dated January 27, 1993, which indicates those changes that were made to the initial plan. What I would like to do is just to go down the list of changes that we made and to point out those areas that we have modified the plan in response to the comments. Just a brief overview. If you recall, Cantel Corporation has a 7-acre tract of land off of Silva Drive. Silva Drive is a fairly short road off of Sawyer Road, and they have a 40-foot right-of-way going into the property. The Cantel Corporation would like to develop a 2.5-acre piece of property for a single-family home several hundred feet back from Silva Drive. 575 feet, more or less, a driveway would be built to accommodate the construction of this home. We had shown earlier a wetland delineation that showed wetlands here at a small stream crossing and another fairly extensive area of wetland down below the building site. We had indicated a place where we felt that a house would best be located within this blue envelope here. We've indicated roughly where a house might best be situated relative to the topography, existing vegetation, and some on-site disposal work that was done, and which we now have an HHE 200 form in your packet. There were a number of comments that were raised by the board, and I'll go down those. before we attempted to make the February meeting, Maureen had issued a review, and I guess the review letter that she presented to us would be a good place to start. In addition to that, we also have a cover letter that we submitted along with the package on January 27th, which lists all the information that's in your packet. We did contact on two occasions the Portland Water District. There was a number of questions that were raised last time, whether or not it would be possible to supply water to the to the single lot without going out to Silva Drive. And we do have a letter from James Pandisco, the customer services representative, indicating that we can indeed tap into this 30-inch water main that crosses the right-of-way, so it won't be necessary to extend the water line all the way to Silva Drive. There was also some concern regarding the culvert that will be placed across the small stream just off of Silva Drive. Steve Roberge, our civil engineer who did the work, has supplied you with a letter on January 26th stating that there should be no adverse impact to downstream properties as a result of the installation of this 36-inch culvert. We should also note that there had been an earlier correspondence from Robert Malley on January 25th, and he was under the mistaken impression that we were going to be using a 30-inch culvert. This has been corrected. We never had intended to use a smaller culvert. It's always been a 36-inch culvert, and that's the size that Mr. O'Burge used in his continued analysis. He felt that neither the velocity or the volume of the water coming from the site would be affected by the installation of this culvert at this point. There was a concern that was raised last time because we did not have the HHE 200 forms that were done by Richard Sweet. We have included those in the packet. We also have a letter from Norm Twaddell, the right-of-way agent for the Portland Water District, talking about the work that may be anticipated as a result of the installation of the driveway crossing it. It does not appear to be a major problem, and he indicates what may have to be done relative to the water, to the blow-off valve. We have submitted to the Department of Environmental Protection a permit by rule notification form, and we submitted all the documentation. And accordingly, we have not heard back from them, which means essentially that the permit by rule application is in effect right now relative to the stream crossing. We also knew that because we are crossing a wetland, we had to have Corps of Engineers involvement. We have had a couple of contacts with Jay Clement of the Corps of Engineers. We submitted a notification procedure for what's called the Nationwide 14 permit for road crossing activity. After we submitted that application, we received a call from Jay Clement asking for additional information, and we haven't heard back from him. Again, the assumption is that the notification is complete. There's no further contact required from the Corps of Engineers. They have indeed been notified. We did make several corrections to the site plan. Several people indicated some concern with our initial setback line from the wetlands as mapped, feeling that it was not really clear whether or not a person could build right up to the edge of the building line. And so we've indicated on the revised plan a 25-foot setback from the southerly boundary of the wetland. So in other words, a person could build anywhere within this building envelope line, but there would always be at least a 25-foot buffer from the wetland. What that does is allow the person who will be buying this property some place within this roughly half-acre square rectangle to build their house. So we have roughly one-fifth of the land that's going to be dedicated to a building envelope. We have made a number of notes following some discussion with the planning board last time. The building envelope is noted, called out. It says that the activities within the building envelope shall be limited to the construction of a driveway and stream crossing, utility installation, and removal of dead or diseased vegetation. That's outside of the building envelope. Secondly, the water service line shall not cross the wetland. There's again some concern raised that if the water service was to come up this way, we could make a diagonal shortcut over to the house site. The note now indicates that the water line has to follow the alignment of the road or somehow stay out of the wetland. The same holds true for wire utilities. They shall not cross the wetland, and they shall do whatever they can if they can be located above ground to avoid wetlands. And the final note has to do with erosion control. One of the permit by rule procedures is that the person who receives the permit by rule has to comply with sections 1 and sections 11 in the permit by rule notification guideline book. And we've included several pages from that chapter 305 permit by rule to show you what the person who will be buying this property and developing a house here will have to comply with. This handles everything from erosion control, seeding mixture, timing, and so forth. There was a note that was changed between the earlier plan and this plan relative to the intersection at Silva Drive with our driveway. We had proposed to change it from a 5-foot radius, which is typical of most of the driveways on the street, to a 20-foot radius in conformance with some earlier recommendations. That was re-reviewed by Fred Morin at T.Y. Lynn. His recommendation was that applying the template, the turning template of a typical fire truck over that, we'd probably need a 25-foot radius. And so we're willing to accept that as a condition of approval, that the note which now says 20-foot on your plan be changed to a 25-foot radius at the intersection of Silva Drive. We've also made a few notes at the emergency turnaround located next to the house. We are showing a 20-foot turnaround, 20-foot radius there, and a 2% maximum grade, again in conjunction with Chief McGoldrick's review of the development. There are a number of minor points that were picked up by Fred Morin's memo of January 12th, which we've changed, the slope on the road and a note on the cross section. There were also a few notes that were revised relative to the width of the roadway. The roadway width has not changed. It's still a 12-foot wide road in the wetlands and a 14-foot wide gravel road outside of the wetlands. Both of those have 2-foot shoulders on either side. And the final revision that we made was simply to make the plan in conformance with the details that we're showing here. We're showing a culvert and a riprap on the upstream end of the culvert, and we're also showing a riprap with a flared section and the concrete pipe on the downstream end. And I believe that covers the changes that were made between the January submittal and the revision that's before you tonight.
Thank you very much, Terry. Appreciate that updating. To jog everybody's memory, it was there. That was one of the coldest site walks I've been on in a long, long time. But the benefit was, if you all remember, there was no snow. And that's been a long time.
Long time ago.
At this point in time, I first will go over the guidelines of a public hearing. If there are members of the public who wish to address the board to express concerns or comments on the agenda item, I just simply ask you to approach the podium, identify yourself, your name and address, and try to limit your remarks to the issue under discussion. This time, I'll open the public hearing. Are there any members of the public who would like to address the planning board? Usually wait a long, long time to see if there's anybody that really wants to. Seeing and hearing none, I close the public hearing. And we'll move right on to board discussion. Any questions, comments, concerns from the board on the article? At this point in time, I'm sorry, I should have appointed another voting member, and at this time I'll appoint Bob Marvin as a voting member. First, again, I'll ask if you have a chance to review the agenda item, and you feel like...
Sure.
Okay, fine. Any questions, comments? Judy?
Mr. DeJuan, did I hear you correctly? You indicated the applicant would be willing, as a condition of approval, to increase the radius at the intersection of Silva Drive to 25 feet.
That's correct.
You were not speaking to the turnaround on the property, which is currently
at 20 feet. We could easily do that also if that was felt to be a problem. I'm just referring to the comments that Fred Morin had in his most recent correspondence with us.
He just said all radii, and I wasn't sure what he meant. So I will turn to you, Maureen. Most recent meeting you had of all these various people interested in the radii, what was the final consensus?
We're still working on it. Was the final consensus. We're working on a template, which is, we believe, to be the minimum turning radius for the ladder truck. However, I have also met with the Ordinance Committee, which is currently reviewing the proposed road standard amendments, and they have some concerns about exactly what radius has to be met residential areas, and there's some question as to how often a ladder truck will be called to those areas. So I unfortunately don't have an answer for you. It seems that a difference between 20 and 25 feet is not significant. We were talking, I think, at one point at a 40-foot radius, which is a big difference. So
50 is what we had even talked about.
Yeah. I guess the standard in the ordinance currently for a public access waiver is 20 feet, but that's for a 22-foot wide traveled way. We're working on it. We haven't gotten far enough where we can move to a new standard. So the board probably should, make a decision. I think anything between 20 to 25, you're certainly in the range of safety.
Mr. DeJuan, how wide does that actually make that driveway cut?
Oh, from one side to the other?
Mm-hmm.
Approximately 37 feet, maybe 40 feet by the time you change the 20 to 25.
Okay. I have another question for you, Maureen. The plans as drawn show a proposed turnaround. Now, when we approve this, does that mean that whoever buys the lot will have to locate the turnaround where it is in the exact configuration?
Yes. One of the requirements in the ordinance for a public access waiver is that whatever is approved by the planning board has to be recorded. The motion before you also makes that a requirement. And I think if you remember, one of the last public access waivers you've done in the past, there was actually a condition written right onto the plan because the applicant said, maybe I'll be moving the turnaround. There was a condition written right onto the plan that said any movement of the turnaround would have to come back to the planning board. So this plan gets recorded. It serves two functions. One, it puts on notice all future owners of the lot that there is a turnaround that has to be on this site. And secondly, it gives the board the authority to go back in and review any change to that turnaround.
Do you see that as being particularly onerous? This lot has a lot of room for a turnaround. If someone comes in and they want to modify it because they're moving their house, would that be fairly easy for a homeowner?
We have had people who've come in with amendments that have done it at one meeting. In addition, the board is just starting to discuss putting some new amendments into the ordinance that would allow staff to review de minimis changes. So it's possible that something like this in the future could actually be approved by staff and re-recorded.
Okay.
So there really aren't an awful lot of options because of the ledge that's out there.
And there isn't.
The homeowner's desire is to save trees.
Okay.
That's probably the likely place to put it. That's probably not the only place.
Okay. The Conservation Commission had made several comments with respect to this property, the deer yard, which it seems like there still will be a large amount of land out there for the deer to go to because of the applicant's holdings. They talked about buffering the wetlands, and I assume that the revised building envelope addresses that concern. The third comment was with respect to erosion control and the need for hay bales. The standards that you referenced before are very general. They indicate you should do this, and if something else is required, maybe do that. Given the type of driveway proposed, do you think something like hay bales or siltation fencing would automatically be required by the nature of the construction?
Yes. Yes, the person is bound to follow the standards in the permit by rule application.
And they would need something of that level of protection. Maureen, how is that enforced? Is that through the building inspector while they are actually constructing this?
I guess what would probably happen is sometime during construction, especially if the house was under construction, the building inspector will be going out there anyway. And since he also is very familiar with the wetlands regulations, I believe that if he saw any significant erosion, he'd be requesting that things be put into place, such as hay bales or silt fencing.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions, comments from the board? Don't all jump at once. I just had one comment that, while I don't think it's essential, I think it's advisable for the 25-foot radii, whichever, at Silver Drive. The turnaround is less crucial. I mean, that one of the complaint or the comment by Fred Moran was that you have to make more than one turn.
That's assuming that the fire truck is on the right-hand side of the road. Chances are this is going to make a big swing. It's going to get into the left-hand side of the road. Wouldn't be a real problem with oncoming traffic here.
It's true. It's a good point. My comment was simply in the turnaround, which you're correct, between the wetlands, the location of the septic system. There's a little other area there, really, where you can put a turnaround. I think that's less important to jockey any equipment around to make that turn. Other comments, concerns? If not, any motion for action? Do we need to play a little music to get everybody awake here?
Mr. Chairman, I propose the following motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact, 1, Juan Perez of the Cantel Corporation is requesting a wetlands alteration permit and public access waiver for a lot to be created off of Silva Drive, which requires review under Section 19-3-9 and Section 19-4-2B of the Zoning Ordinance. 2, the application was deemed complete at the regular January 1993 meeting of the Planning Board, and a public hearing was held March 16, 1993. 3, access to and from the lot must be constructed and maintained according to the plans to be in compliance with the Planning Board approval. 4, the plan substantially complies with the requirements of Section 19-3-9, Wetlands Regulations, and Section 19-4-2B, Public Access Waiver of the Zoning Ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Juan Perez of the Cantel Corporation for a wetlands alteration permit and public access waiver for lot U46-9A located off of Silva Drive be granted subject to the following conditions. 1, that the approved plan be recorded in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds no later than May 16, 1993. Actually, I'm going to revise that to June 16, 1993, in accordance with Section 19-4-2B. 2, the radius on the westerly side of the intersection of the driveway with Silva Drive be increased to 25 feet.
Second. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Is it clear what the motion is? Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd like to welcome Mr. Emery tonight with a drum roll, new vice chair. Tom Emery. He's always a little bit late. It's good. Burning up the pavement. The next item under old business, In by the Sea site plan amendments. A request by the In by the Sea Realty Trust for amendments to the previously approved site plan for the Inn by the Sea located on Bowery Beach Road, site plan approval, section 19-2-10. representative of the applicant is at the podium. If you could perhaps just briefly review amendments, changes since our last meeting.
Thank you. Good evening, Board. My name is Steve Moore. I'm here on behalf of the Inn by the Sea. As the Chair has directed, just very briefly, at the last meeting there were several unresolved issues with regard to the Inn by the Sea's application. Subsequent to the public hearing and review by the Board, the final items that were discussed were, first, a letter from the State Department of Human Services approving the expansion of the Inn by the Sea subsurface disposal system. And you'll find in your packets a letter dated February 23rd from Jay Hardcastle approving the system as designed and giving permission to the Inn to expand to 48 seats and open for 3 meals to the general public. The other issue, which has been discussed at great length, is the issue of water testing and specifically sampling and sampling levels and standards which will be used to review the Inn by the Sea's sampling program. And again, just to go back and touch on those issues, as a part of the previous submission in January, the Inn by the Sea had outlined the testing procedures which it will be doing at its expense to provide the Town Conservation Commission with baseline information on surface water quality in the marsh, as well as testing the two piezometer test wells that are immediately below the inn for groundwater water quality. And what is at question is specifically the standards that are going to be used to evaluate the information that's submitted to the town. We have indicated all along that the inn's interest in surface water sampling was to provide the town with baseline information on the marsh. If you read the Normando report, which was submitted at the board's request, they are fairly clear in that in terms of identifying that the marsh receives surface water from a variety of sources and that the high nitrate levels and the phosphate levels do fluctuate, and in fact there are a variety of sources which could contribute to that, and that the inn itself could not be pinpointed as the major contributor or even a significant contributor to that. In particular, they cited the groundwater quality in the wells and the fact that in the piezometer wells, the nitrate levels are less than the surface water quality in the marsh. So based on that information, we're proposing that we will supply the town with those surface water test results at the time of our annual health permit renewal. And over a period of time, they'll be able to accrue and develop baseline data on the marsh. With respect to the two piezometers, we're proposing a different approach in that the piezometers are there specifically to monitor the health of the inn's subsurface disposal system. What we're proposing is that we use the Department of Environmental Protection standards for looking at surface water, groundwater quality, excuse me, and specifically avoid the issue of drinking water standards and look rather to what the department does for subsurface water systems, which is to look at nitrates being below the 40 milligrams per liter level, and that a few fecal coliform be translated into the 5 colonies per 100 milliliter. So we've established that using the state's criteria as the guidelines that we will be submitting to you under. If we find, in fact, that we exceed those with the two test well results, what we're representing is that we will turn around and proceed with the study to look at specifically what might be causing those elevated levels, bring that back to the town for the town to review, and then proceed with the necessary mitigation steps to correct what we identify as the problem. And we submitted that for the record, again, so that the town has something to fall back on, some recourse to look at both the piezometer test results with respect to how the inn itself is operating. I think that really summarizes the couple of issues that the board had asked for further information on. We did, in January, submit the fertilization records and reports that we had from the inn itself, as well as what we had planned to do for the next several years in terms of fertilization and lawn care, insect and weed treatment. And again, that's in the information in the packet before you. I think that really covers the last of the key issues that the board had asked about. And with that as a brief synopsis, I'll turn it back to the board. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Steve. That was a good summary. I guess at this time I'll turn it back to the planning board. We're at a full complement of regular members, full members. Any questions, comments, concerns? No questions. Judy?
Very minor one. Steve, when do you expect you will have shop drawings of the grease and grit trap?
I actually have those shop drawings now. I'm reviewing them myself, and then once I've approved them, I'm going to send them out to the town engineer.
Is there any reason why it would be onerous to have that as a condition?
Oh, not at all, okay. No.
Thank you.
Mark?
Steve, the installation of the grease and grit trap, is this a very sensitive and delicate operation, the success of its installation depending upon highly critical procedures, or is this a sort of a more of a low-tech sort of operation?
It's much more low-tech than one would expect from the name. The grease and grit trap, the key element on that is that it be placed relatively level. That's the only criteria that really goes on the installation of those. Because of the way the baffles are set up, it just needs to be within, I think on this size tank, our tolerance is about an inch to an inch and a half of level across the run of the tank.
Any other questions, Steve Parkhurst?
I hope it's an easy question to answer, but what is an organic carrier for fertilizer? Does that constitute completely organic? What is an organic carrier?
Tom, can you?
No, I'll let you.
When chemicals are actually set up in the fertilizing plants, the chemicals are set up with a carrier agent that actually bears the fertilization particles themselves and carries them as they get either through soluble or just gradual transition in the soil broken up and carried out. In the past, those carrier agents weren't always organic. Sometimes they were just inert chemical compounds. And one of the things that's happened in the past, I guess, decade or so, is that they try and work very closely with organic carriers so you're not getting residual chemicals into the lawn.
Okay. Then is the fertilizer chemicals, are they chemicals or are they organic natural fertilizers?
They are, in fact, chemicals that are bonded to an organic base.
And the other thing question I had was, you're going to be testing twice a year and only submitting once at the time of the annual permit renewal?
Correct.
I assume one of the tests will be done pretty much just prior to the permit renewal, and the other one will be done 6 months either side of that.
That's correct.
If something in that other test shows something onerous, what will be done at that point?
I suspect that if, in fact, we find that threshold is exceeded in the piezometer wells, my advice to the Inn by the Sea would to bring that forward to Ernie so we can start to work on it, because the process of studying that issue and identifying and getting it resolved could take several months. So I feel that probably the appropriate thing to do is, if in fact at that interval period we find the piezometers exceeding that, we would want to bring that to Ernie's attention.
Would you have any problem with that being part of the process?
I don't. I'm looking to Maureen McQuaid from the Inn. No, if you wish to place that as a condition or rewrite the testing piece.
I'm not quite sure how you want to do it, but I would say that if a red flag popped up on that alternate test, then the town should be alerted as soon as possible so they could begin work on the solution of that problem.
I have no problem at all with that.
Maureen, did you have a comment? Okay. Anything further, Steve? Anything from the associate members? Simply not voting, does he certainly can be involved in the discussion, ask questions. Okay. I'd like to thank you as the applicant. You've done a good job. I think maybe I was the one that pushed, especially on the fertilizing and the water testing. at least at the beginning. I think you've done an admirable job. The Normando report, I'd like to ask, make sure the planner forwards this report to the Conservation Committee. I think they hold an important role and as a natural resource here in the town of watching this. And I think what you have set forward is admirable, and I think the point's well taken. You're one of 50 or 20 or however many abutters to this property. I think what I've been trying to urge is that you don't become the leading contributor instead of the least contributor. And I think what you set forth is a leadership role in doing that. I certainly see what the guidelines that you've set forth is being real acceptable as far as I'm concerned. I'd ask Maureen if you feel, Maureen, that what's set forth here and as it's referred to on the plan is sufficient to regulate the testing program from the point of view of the town.
I think the applicant also has done an admirable job in setting this up so that it's very clear for staff to understand exactly what's going to happen. Just rechecked it again, but there is a note on the plan that states that the applicant mm-hmm. will be doing the testing twice a year and submitting that at the time of the annual health inspection. Plus, Mr. Moore has gone forward, and I explained our difficulty and what will we do with the test results once we got them. And now that we have this letter laying out these standards, I think it's going to be very easy for the code enforcement officer to get those tests and look at this letter and say, okay, they're all set for this year. So he's really laid this out. So I think there's a real possibility that actually will be used.
Good. As far as the reporting of fertilization of the grounds, I wasn't even looking for any more than what you reported in last year's and this year's, and I guess a future expectation. I think just as long as there's some record of that accompanies the health permit application. Is sufficient. I guess at this point I have no other questions. Any other questions of the board members, from the board members? Not, do I hear a motion for any action?
I won't propose another one tonight.
Okay, Judy?
I propose the following motion for the board to consider findings of fact. One, HMH Limited Partnership is requesting site plan approval to open the restaurant at the Inn by the Sea, located on Bowery Beach Road, to the public and construct a parking lot and new subsurface disposal system, which requires review under Section 19-2-10 of the Zoning Ordinance. Two, the site is located immediately up gradient of a marsh in Crescent Beach State Park, which could suffer adverse impacts from this expansion of use of the Inn. Three, completion of the site improvements as depicted on the project plans is necessary to assure compliance with the Planning Board approval. Four, the application substantially complies with Section 19-2-10 of the Zoning Ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of HMH Limited Partnership for amendments to the site plan approval for the Inn by the Sea to permit opening the restaurant to the public and construction of a new parking lot and subsurface disposal system be granted subject to the following conditions. One, that the applicant perform water quality testing as outlined in the document entitled IBS Water Quality Testing, which was included in a letter from Stephen Moore to the town planner dated January 27, 1993, and as noted on the plans. Two, that the applicant use the methodology outlined in a letter from Stephen Moore to the town planner dated February 24, 1993, to evaluate water quality test samples and to ensure proper functioning of the in subsurface disposal system. Three, that the grease and grit trap shop drawings be submitted to the town engineer. And four, that no temporary or permanent certificate of occupancy be issued to allow the restaurant to open to the public until all site improvements have been deemed complete by the town engineer.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion? I just have one small. I think the plan refers to the letter that you referred to as the 27th, which is the correct date is the 28th on the plan.
I think the letter was the 27th.
It is. Maureen, do you see that as a problem?
No.
Okay. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Congratulations.
Thank you. If I might ask the board for their indulgence for just two or three more minutes. One of the issues that we had discussed with the town planner and Ernie and also Jay Hardcastle with the state early on was looking at the possibility of having the restaurant open on a very limited basis, notwithstanding the last condition that you just read in your order. And I'm wondering if I could ask this informally of the board, not for a vote, but rather just a sense of reaction from the board. When we put this original package together, we had hoped to be out to bid this month and be breaking ground at the end of the month so we could have our operation in place by late May. With the snowfall, that's not going to happen. And one of the issues that the inn has asked me to explore is the ability to have some of the seats open to the public on a limited basis. And my question is, would the board at all be receptive if we were to come back at the next meeting with a proposal to have some limited seats or the inn's restaurant open on a very limited basis that would be a function of something that we would work out with code enforcement as far as number of seats to be occupied versus occupancy of the inn? And if it's something you can't answer, I'll understand that as well. But in the interest of the inn, I was trying to get some sense of reaction from the board if that would all be palatable or if it's just unacceptable and we should proceed with the site plans.
I guess as a chair, I would only respond that being cautious, I'm not sure that we're in a position to state. And I urge the board members to be cautious about staying whether we're looked upon it favorably or not. I think if the procedure is correct that you'd come back, we certainly will listen to that request. I'm not sure whether the zoning board, did they receive zoning board approval first?
Yes, they did. And I frankly have not researched this in light of what the zoning board's approval stated. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't tell you. I guess my concern was there was an issue raised early in this review process about whether or not the applicant would be presenting a performance guarantee. And the decision, I believe, was made by the board that a guarantee wouldn't be needed and that there would be no opening of the restaurant to the public prior to that time. And that's what's controlling the fact that these improvements actually are going to be done on the site. If the restaurant is open to the public, it becomes very difficult at that point to make sure that the improvements are going to be done. The only way you can enforce it at that point is to close the restaurant, something that's difficult to do once people are operating it.
Look for any comment from the board. Tom?
I guess I have a personal opinion, but I don't know what basis it has either in zoning or the ordinances, and that's to encourage successful business. And I understand the weather conditions and all of that, so I would certainly be acceptable to looking at whatever appropriate application this applicant would have for either the zoning board or planning board or code enforcement officer.
Anyone else?
Thank you for the courtesy of hearing me on that.
Certainly.
Point. Thank you.
Thank you. And good luck. Moving to new business this evening, the next agenda item is the Great Pond Walkway Wetlands Alteration Permit, request by the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission for a wetlands alteration permit to construct a woodland walkway and bridge in the wetland adjacent to the Great Pond. Application completeness, section 19-3-9. If a representative of the Conservation Commission could come to the podium, introduce yourself, and give us a brief description of what you're proposing.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Board, my name is Jack Roberts, and I'm, at least until Thursday, the Chairman of the Conservation Commission. I have with me tonight Natalie Burns, who is on our commission, and an attorney with the City of Portland, and also a planner. John Mitchell, who is our resident expert, who is a volunteer, and Pat Carroll, who is a member of the Conservation Commission as well, and they may be able to answer some of the questions for you. What we're seeking is to put down basically planking over a wet area of a trail in order to protect it from the foot traffic that we anticipate be going down through there. The project that we're doing is part of the Casco Bay Estuary project, and Councilor Pearson had requested that we seek funding for that, which we did, and with the approval of the town council for the overall project in general. We had first attempted to secure a right-of-way above the wetland area on private property, and our attempts to do that were not successful. Hence, that is why we're here before you, to try to get I hesitate to call it a catwalk or a boardwalk, because it's nothing that elaborate. It's merely some planking on timbers to facilitate people crossing an area that could be disturbed by too much foot traffic. The trail would be allowed without any permitting required in that area. But as I indicated, we have concerns that the land not be disturbed, and we want to keep people in the area that we mark. It will be an educational, scientific type of a research project or nature trail, and this is allowed under 19-2-8-02 under the RPI 1 zone. We would like to get some quick action on this, obviously, as the grant money was supposed to have been, or the grant was supposed to have been completed by December. We were able to get an extension on that, and then, of course, the snowstorm has also set us back another month as well. I know you've heard that at least twice tonight already. Pat Carroll and myself did go to the DEP to speak with representatives there, and I'll have Pat talk to you about our success over there. We had requested three waivers. One of those, I believe, we have complied with, and Natalie Burns can address that for you. So I would ask this Pat if he would at least briefly discuss our meeting with the DEP and where we stand with them.
I guess the whole issue of DEP arose out of the fact that we are intending to construct what is called a permanent structure according to Maine DEP, and that's because this structure won't be in place on a year-round basis. If in fact we were to construct a boardwalk that would be removed or only in place for 7 months out of the year, then they would call it a temporary structure and we'd really be exempt from their control. But because it is what's considered a permanent structure, we will be proceeding with a full NRPA permit application. We have had an initial pre-application conference with the Maine DEP and reviewed the plans and went over the project with them, and their response was overwhelmingly positive about it, not only in the fact that they would support the project because it does provide public access to Great Pond. It's a part of the Casco Bay Estuary project, and the fact that also the fact that because of their current workload at the current time, they foresee that this permit could be issued fairly rapidly. So it really wouldn't impede our schedule as far as trying to complete this spring. So we are now in the process of filling out that application and submitting to DEP, and we'll follow up on that.
Good. Thanks.
Natalie, would you address the waivers?
Thank you. As Jack mentioned, we had originally requested three separate waivers. The first of these was the requirement for a topographic map. The second was the requirement for a soils map. And the third is the requirement for a stormwater runoff plan. At the workshop meeting, one of the board members had requested that, in fact, we do submit the topographic map, which we have done, so we're no longer requesting that waiver. However, we did discover tonight, as we were reviewing staff's memo, that, in fact, we needed to show a scale of 1 inch equals 100 feet, and that what we have shown is 1 inch equals 200 feet. So I believe we need to request a waiver of that as well this evening. A brief explanation of why we did not provide a soils map is that we have determined that there is one soils type in the area and that there are no other soils in the area of the proposed walkway. And for the stormwater runoff plan, there will not be stormwater runoff associated with this project because there won't be any grading as part of the project.
Thank you, Natalie. Any questions at this point?
I think, Jack, typical way that we proceed with a completeness issue, and I remind the board that this is the first order of business is completeness, not technical merit of the application, is that we simply walk down through, or typically have Maureen walk us down through the checklist, and at that time we ask you questions as we go along. And I guess if the board wishes, and I see them all nodding yes, we'll simply walk down through the checklist. Maureen?
Well, I think the applicant's pretty much touched on it. The wetlands regulations do require a scale of 1 inch equals 100 feet on the plan. The applicant's plan is submitted one in, plan of 1 inch equals 200 feet. Again, the board has varied on that from time to time if there's been a good reason for it. On the second one, the waiver for submitting topographic information, the applicant has submitted a map, which I think was in your February package. So that's no longer something that's being requested as a waiver, although, again, it is a slightly larger scale than what you're used to seeing. Third, the high-intensity soils map. I think the reason the applicant is requesting a waiver is that they're conceding that they are in the most restrictive soil that is recognized under a zoning ordinance. They are in an area that is very poorly drained soils. And if they did a soils study, all they would show is that they are still under the same restrictions we are assuming they're under. So I don't think the code enforcement officer and I certainly don't have any question about what the soils are in that area. Fourth, the footbridge under H, I believe, is an issue of existing flow of water courses. Again, I believe that the bridge that the applicant has constructed is up on pillars, and there's no intent to alter or reduce the flow of any water that's there currently. It was just something I was noting to the board so that they were aware that that's something they may want to be interested in. Are there any questions? I guess the only other thing I didn't address is the stormwater runoff plan. It is something that's required. The applicant is asserting that they're not going to make any alteration to existing stormwater flows because of the design of the walkway and the bridge, and it's just in the amount of area that it's actually going to cover. Are there any questions?
Any board questions? Again, pertaining to completeness at this step. Yeah. Seeing none, do I hear a motion for any action? Steve?
You had ordered that based on the plans, materials submitted, and the facts presented, the application of the Papers and Confirmation Commission for Wetlands Alteration Permit and Construction of the Great Pond Walkway be deemed complete. Be it further ordered that a public hearing is scheduled for the regular March 6th, April 20th, 1993 meeting of the planning board.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Just as a reminder, because this is a wetlands alteration, need for public hearing, which was made a part of this motion. Is there any other further discussion? Seeing and hearing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Thank you, and see you at the public hearing next month.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, is it inappropriate to add any comments now that might the applicant may want to look at before they come back to the next meeting?
Sure. Jack, the question was appropriate for comments that you may want to look at before or as you come back next month, and I don't see any reason why not to.
Go ahead. On the deed that you submitted showing the Sprague Corporation's granting of these easements, there was a clause stating that if at some point the trail needed to be relocated from a Butters property onto Sprague Corporation's property, you would need their approval. Is that the case from where it was on the higher area and now you're moving it into the wetlands?
No, the area that we walked with John Green from the Sprague Corporation was with us. I'm not sure exactly what they meant on that, and certainly not in that area, because that's all a contiguous parcel that follows from Fenway into Fenway Road right over to the area that goes up through the land trust property.
Okay, so this is an existing trail right now?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. I don't know how you would address this, but the town engineer's comments with respect to showing that the bridge is graphically above the water level, but he can make no judgments with respect to 10, 25-year storms, if there will be any obstruction. And I can only imagine we're talking about debris floating, catching on the bridge and causing some obstruction. If you folks would look at that and come back with some comment that you can state, and I'm not asking for it now, but that we know that this is not going to cause a stormwater problem in a higher storm event. And we had some discussion at the last meeting about increasing at least the width of the bridge to possibly accommodate wheelchairs, and I don't know if that meant the ramps to it or just building a bridge of a certain width. I'd like to see what your final proposal is next time. And as one board member, I would really like to look at a finalized bridge design. I know you want to locate it in the field, so that the length you might have to play with and the actual footings, but you should, I think, be able to give us the true width and the height of the railings and all that. As one board member, I feel like we're caught here because this is a wonderful project. You have limited funds, and I don't want you to expend them unneeded, but I also don't want to feel like we haven't looked at this hard enough, whereas any other applicant would have a tougher look. And then the last thing I would ask is, Maureen, under the wetlands provisions, do they need to have the DEP permit to us before we approve that, or is that just site plan and subdivision?
I would just say we've always, at least the years that I've been on the board, tried to make sure that we treat other municipal groups, entities, the same as we do other applicants. And we just need to keep that in mind as we proceed.
Your question as to whether they need to have DEP approval in hand, there's no specific requirement under the wetlands regulations that requires that. There is an open-ended submission requirement under N, where the town planner may require additional information as needed. And then there's a list of things that could be required. So if the board wanted to require that, you could.
But we don't have.
You don't have to.
Thank you.
I guess I'd just like to make a couple of comments on the bridge. I have lived down by the pond for 11 years, and there aren't significant rises in the level. There's no tributaries coming into the pond to affect that water level rising on a rapid basis. So you don't get the kind of runoff that you would in a situation like that. I don't see if the bridge, perchance, was washed out or something, it'd be up to the Conservation Commission, I guess, to retrieve it and put it back up. We don't want to change the grading or anything there. Certainly, making it 36 inches would be fine, although it is a nature trail, and it's not going to be accessible for anybody. The reason that we put it at 32 inches was to discourage vehicular traffic over it, as we want it for pedestrian only. I think if push came to shove, I guess, and we couldn't get the material we need on the bridge, we probably would ask to have that deleted, because we do not want to hold up the trail itself. The bridge is extremely important for us continuing along to Fenway at a future date, and certainly we'd like to have it part of this application.
Maureen?
I guess just to supplement Jack's comments on the handicap accessibility, I am also the staff person for the Conservation Commission, and several months ago they asked me to do some research on whether or not the trails that they're putting in have to be accessible. The information that I was able to get at that time suggested that portions of the green belt have to be accessible to the handicap, but the entire system of green belt trails does not have to be accessible. Okay. And again, the problem here is that you're dealing with some very steep banks. It would be very difficult, and most of the trail is actually just dirt. So I think it would be difficult in this particular location to make the whole trail accessible.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
And you also, in the next month, you may have a chance to see, if we get lots of rain, you'll see just how much of a flood action you get there. I expect you out there with your camera. Take a picture. We're almost back on schedule. The next order of new business before us is Beals Ice Cream site plan, request by Beals Old Fashioned Ice Cream for a change of use from Fish and Farm Market to an ice from the Fish and Farm Market to an ice cream store located at 300 Ocean House Road. Site plan review completeness, section 19-2-9. As the applicant representative thereof comes to the podium, I remind the board that this is an action for review completeness, not technical merit. If you could introduce yourself and give us a brief overview of what you're proposing.
Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Pete Malia, and this is my brother Jim, the ice cream maker himself. We propose to convert the former Cape Fish and Farm Market, located right next door here at 330 Ocean House Road, to a Beals ice cream store. We originally submitted our plans in October of 92. That application was deemed incomplete. We had some debate within our family. It's a family owned and operated ice cream business as to whether we wanted to proceed, given the fact that we were looking at a little bit more of a financial investment than we had initially expected. And eventually we decided to pursue the project. We hired a land surveyor. We asked him to bring us into compliance with section 19-2-10, and more specifically to address the deficiencies that were set forth in the town planner's letter of incompleteness, which was dated October 20th, I believe. We resubmitted our application on February 19th, and on March 12th we received a letter from the town planner which contained a summary of possible incomplete items, and that's what brings us here today. We brought this list of possible incomplete items to the attention of our land surveyor, and he addressed these items and provided us with plans which contain these revisions, which specifically address these items. We'd be happy to give each of you one of these as we point out his revisions to specifically address these items if the board so desires. Is that something that
I think if you have additional information, we typically don't review that the night of a plan, but if you want to leave it with Maureen, that's fine. If you can summarize what you have, feel free to go ahead and
proceed. Well, if you want to join me here, my brother Jim, there's, let's see, one, two, three.